Welcome to our humble home, where we're going to launch some of Mary's video channels, hopefully, and hopefully you will watch them and subscribe to them. And don't forget, ring that bell, Mary, ring that button, and we will let you know when more videos are coming along. We have some fantastic ones coming up. You won't want to miss these. The Lulu's fantastic. This video is from RTE Television, and it's What Do You Believe? It's called. And Mary is on this with Fr Noel Watson, who's a priest that travelled all over Ireland with us. And in fact, Fr Noel has travelled to, would you believe, Las Vegas, Ensenada, Rosarita, Mexico, Canada. And the only place he didn't visit with us was, oh, in San Diego, of course, is Hawaii. He couldn't make it to Hawaii. But nevertheless, we keep in touch. What do you think, Mary?
He's a lovely, lovely man, lovely priest. He'd give his heart to anybody. Yeah. And so he tried to stick with us as much as he could when he had breaks.
Yeah. So he's still doing healing work in Ireland, which is good. He's seeing people. He's only a young man for a priest, you know. And that's...
he's a great healer.
He is, yeah.
Himself, he's a great healer. Father Malone is the same.
Yeah.
He used to take me down to the hospital in Roscommon.
Yes.
For healing.
All the hospitals Mary went in, Longford and Roscommon, Father Malone would join her.
A marvellous singer. Oh, you'd stand all night listening to him sing. He used to sing like
John McCormack.
John McCormack.
May I carry on?
Go on now.
Thank you. If you need to learn more about Mary's life and website, is www.marymalone.com, or you can email Mary at mvickers@hotmail.co.uk. And thank you very much. And it's a bit long-winded, but we shall get over that. Okay, bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come.
And to be fit and
healthy in body, soul, and spirit. Eternal Father, we offer you the body and blood. For the sake of his sorrowful passion.
I see the Rora, and I'll say to myself, I'm going to plaster the Rora now. And often it takes the pain away. You're cracked. You know, when you're ill, that aura is cracked.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins.
I didn't learn it. It was just something that was given to me within my own head. It's the sight that I have. I have an insight, or God's third eye, that often opens for me, and I can see those things.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us
sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
And say the glory be to the Father,
and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be.
We are not the healers. It's Christ working his life, or his energy. But we don't trust the healing within our own church. We don't trust that when we come to the Eucharist, that the life and love, this life-giving bread, this saving cup, flows through us and somehow releases the healing in us.
She prayed of me, and I say she can't do us any harm, hopefully some good.
Leah often says, do you feel the heat? You always feel great after just a blessing.
I'm suffering with my eyes at the moment, and Father Watson is very good. He gives me healing.
Now, when I was a young man, I remember having a big argument with a Christian nurse who believed in healing, and I thought it was all hogwash. But now, all those years later, I'm certain that it does happen.
Father Pat Collins has been involved in the healing ministry himself. He's now studying for a PhD on the subject. He believes healing should be more central in Catholicism today.
I think it's part of ecclesiastical control. You see, that only the clerics can do the healing, and only through the sacraments. Don't let the lay people loose on this, because they'll only make a mess of everything. And I think that was the implicit idea, so that it was a specialised thing for the institutional church. And so we were left with kind of little oases of healing, like Lourdes and the odd saint, like Padre Pio. But it was notable by its absence. And if you ask church people, what about healing? They'd say, well, the big hospitals are doing it and the psychiatrists are doing it. That's Christ healing in the modern world. I wouldn't deny that it's a form of healing, but that seems to me to be the church washing its hands of its whole responsibility to heal the sick.
If the mainstream churches have left the pitch clear, there's no shortage of other players in this unregulated market. One of the best-known healers in Ireland was originally Mary Barrett from Galway. She constantly travels around the world with her husband Malcolm Vickers under the name Mary Malone, preaching a return to prayer and the rosary.
Mary Malone, you're very welcome to the programme, Mary. You're actually going to say the prayer with us a little later on,
yes,
not just yet,
yes.
Because
a lot of people, Ray, gets healed over the air with this prayer.
Well, hopefully the lady who's on the phone now, maybe if you just put your headphones on there, you'll be able to hear. Margaret Fay, I think, is joining me now. Hello, Margaret.
Hello, Ray.
You have a problem, do you?
Yes, I do.
What is it?
Trapped nerve.
Is this at the back of your head as well?
No.
Where is the trapped nerve?
Down my leg.
Illness is steps to heaven, offered up for the souls in purgatory. Now, the trapped nerve that I'm seeing here, is there a limp? Are you limping?
Well, I suppose, yes. I could be. Well, with the trapped, when the nerve gets bad.
Yeah, did you get a bad
fall? Where do you think the healing comes from?
The healing only comes from the Holy Spirit, nowhere else. It is coming from God, or Jesus.
And how do you explain that? Why are some people cured and other people not?
This is a question that has been asked many, many, many times. And really, it's very hard to answer that. The only answer I can give you, and it is from my own heart, really, because of how I've been sick myself for so long and then got healed all of a sudden after 48 years. I think we all have to do our little bit of suffering. And sure, does it matter? I always say to the people when they're grumbling, oh, God is not listening to my prayers. Well, my answer to them is, if they'd only see the golden steps to heaven out of their illness.
Do you believe that the illness or the suffering comes from God?
I wouldn't think so. I wouldn't think for one moment. I think it's the free will that we get ourselves so, as I said, bogged down in everything in life that we don't pray. And when we do get ill, you know, and it's our own doing. It may be what we're eating, it may be stress of some kind. God doesn't give us any of those things. This is what we bring on ourselves.
How long are you doing the healing services?
Well, since I've come here, actually, it's 9 years now. I started on the first Friday, and from that, then I decided I would have a special hour on a Tuesday night where people would come and feel more relaxed, because sometimes at Mass a lot of words and different things and a time of quiet and prayer, because I wanted to teach people how to pray, first of all. Like, I admired a certain Jesuit who came here and he was really very good, and he'd introduced him. So, well, why not continue that? So I was going to do it on a Tuesday night over in the little room across here, but then I decided people mightn't just come into the room, they might feel a little bit inhibited and you might lose out on people. So we started here, and from that we decided then to do the hour from 8 to 9. And then, I suppose, the whole nature of healing, I decided to do, if people wanted to come between 7 and 8 for a special time of extra prayer or healing.
Okay.
did you find that you had the gift of healing yourself?
Well, I've always believed in the blessing of the oil. It goes way back, I suppose. My first parish was 18 years ago, where people would have asked me to go out to visit somebody in hospital. And they would have said to me, you know, would you visit so-and-so, maybe in St. James's? And I would bring the oil and Joe would say the prayer. And from that, people got better, or spiritually helped. And from that, I got a confidence. But I would say it's only in the last 2 or 3 years where I would have come to own the gift that God has given me.
Spirit. Amen. Okay. My pleasure to remind you of his love for you and the things holy peace to protect you, my Jehovah. Send her angels over Phyllis and to be close to her in her love and her search of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
How do other priests react to you?
I must say in this parish the priests are very good, very supportive. And I suppose people are always suspicious sometimes when you say, like, you do the healing, who are you to do the healing? But I find I stand back and when I explain to them that it's spiritual healing and it's peace that you give people foremost, then they begin to understand. But I presume there are a few people who would say, you know, why does he have it? Or, and it challenges them really in their own faith maybe, or they don't fully understand what you're about. Because there's so many different kinds of healers, I'd say, in the church or in the community or in Ireland, that I suppose people get confused what you are doing, you know.
All power can be abused, and it can be used for the glorification of the person who has the power, and perhaps in order to control others and to manipulate others, and maybe to get money. So it's wide open to abuse. And the only person who can afford to be a real healer is somebody with enormous compassion and great humility, that they're not in it for themselves, they're genuinely in the ministry of healing for the sake of others.
People look at you and they see you jetting around the world. You spend most of your time travelling and they say, this is a business.
Well, I wish sometimes it was, you know, but it's not. It's far from a business. You're in and out. We never see the country really that we're in because I'm working all the time. And it's like in Ireland, when I go into Ireland, I'm working. It's not a holiday. You're living in out of a suitcase. You're living in hotels or B&Bs. There is a charge, of course, at the door, and there's somebody always there at the door to take the money. That helps with the expenses.
Well, good evening, everybody. I didn't think there'd be so many here. I didn't know if anybody even heard me on the radio this afternoon, but you see, yeah, we're tuned in. And the Blessed Mother, of course, picks the people that she wants here this afternoon.
But you wouldn't believe it, even though that I'm out there 20 years, that often we may not have the price of petrol to go into that town. I have to pray and pray to the Blessed Mother, and out of the blue it comes. The same thing going to Medjugorje. So you do not make money out of healing, unless that was something very big and massive.
May the power of the Holy Spirit heal you in body, soul and spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. And Father, restore him to full health in mind and body so that you can serve him.
I restore you to full health in mind and body so that you can serve him the rest of
your life. I see the angel Gabriel there around you. And somebody likes music. Who's that? Do you like music?
Because
he's playing as if there's music he's playing around you.
Try to keep it as small as I can, that I can reach the people, that I have time to talk to them and time to share God's love. That if it went out of proportion in me, I wouldn't be able to see everybody. You know? I mean, if you have a full day, isn't that enough to try and help? And I try in my own way to help each and every one of them.
Put yourself down here. How many people today heard Mary on LMFM radio with Ray Storm? He's a very nice guy, Ray, isn't he? Lovely guy. And how many people saw the advertisement in the Drogheda Independent?
What is Malcolm's role?
Oh, he's a bigger role than me, I tell you. He's the one that pays all the expenses, get me from A to B, and hire the cars and or buy the cars or whatever that we need at the time.
Thank you very much for coming, Jack.
Thank you very much for coming.
All right. Listen, you'll be like a spring chicken tomorrow. We hope so anyway.
Are there healers that you'd worry about?
I'd be a bit wary of people who, for example, would do a weekend course in healing or over a few weeks and feel then that they can go out then and heal people. I feel, for me, as I say, it's taken so many years to, I suppose, to be conscious of what I'm doing and the responsibility, again, because people could charge and people will do anything to have, you know, healing for people. Say somebody who's a sick child, and nearly go and sell their house, or if they come to me, I know how desperate they are. And there are, I feel there are people who would, you know, may take advantage of other people.
Good afternoon. What's your problem?
I suffer from depression and anxiety attacks, and kind of a fear comes over me. And I dream a lot about my dead mother, and I always get annoyance after that, you know.
Yeah, pray for the holy souls.
I do pray. Yeah.
But you have allergies as well, do you know about that?
Have I?
And that may trigger off some of your problem.
Yeah.
Are you not on tablets, though?
I am, yeah.
Are you taking about eight? Or more?
Four. Yeah.
Double it. You might have to double it at some stage there. Have you wrote to me at all?
A woman said she suffered from depression and she took four tablets a day.
You
had seen an eight on your glass and you said maybe you should double the medication.
Yeah.
I felt that was a risky thing to do.
Well, did I say to go to the doctor? Usually
no,
I tell her.
Didn't.
No, did I not? No. Yeah. Well, there was an eight there, or it could be even eight weeks. Did she not know what that was? Did she give me an answer to that?
No, she said she was on four tablets.
Oh, yeah. But it wasn't helping her.
No.
It wasn't helping.
No, my point is...
I understand what you're trying to say.
Do you sometimes give advice for maybe...
Well, when I do, very rarely I give an advice like that. I would say to them, go to your GP and see what he is going to say or she's going to say to you. I very rarely, that unless it was something that was not serious, you know, then I might say to them, oh, well, you know, take such a thing. And that's the nurse coming out of me, and I shouldn't do that, you say, unfortunately.
These people can be very gifted and have a genuine gift of healing and then go beyond the level of their competence and say things that are foolish and imprudent. And from a psychological point of view and a counselling point of view, those things would strike me as silly at the least and harmful quite often.
I don't make false promises to people. But sometimes in my own spirit I feel this person may die, but I don't say that. But I stand back and say, well, leave in the Lord's hands and see what, because he is the healer, and if he works through, it's fine. On the other hand, I've seen great things happen, you know, when times I would have thought the person would have died and been surprised. So for that reason, I don't make false promises.
It struck me yesterday. There were nearly 100 people there in that hall. And even if one or two was healed, there was 98 or 99 going away, disappointed, possibly more depressed afterwards, and yet you were gone, like you come like a star and you're gone.
Right. It doesn't finish there with me. They'll now write to me as well, and it's maybe a couple of days, you know, that they'll find that pain is gone, or they'll go to the hospital and the x-ray isn't being at all what they thought it would be, and they feel relaxed with it, or they'll go out with a feeling of love anyway within themselves, and that's the love of God. But it could be when they're at home in bed at night that the healing could take place. You know, it's the Holy Spirit that does the healing.
Now, healing's really is accelerating the healing power that the body has anyway. So it's a process which the body might have healed. And certainly when the Holy Spirit hits a person's immune system with a surge of energy, it seems as if the body is able to fight back and recover its health. Say with cancer, where it's been losing the battle and the person goes to a healer and all of a sudden they feel maybe heat in their body, they feel a new hope and a confidence that they're getting better. And sure enough, when they go back to the doctor, they find that the cancerous growth has gotten much smaller and eventually it disappears. Now, a skeptic could say, well, that was just natural remission. And I can understand that objection. I just believe that the Holy Spirit can help the immune system and that it, you know, it's holistic, that it's all interconnected, that the Spirit's working in our spirit, it works in our mind and it works in our body, and it helps the natural processes of healing. But it's not miraculous. It's not going beyond what nature's capable of anyway.
In the Gospels, healing was central. And yet today in the church seems kind of embarrassed about
it. Far out with it, yes. And sometimes I feel very sad about that, because priests are, you know, they have their hands anointed, that they should be the first ones to give healing before any lay person. And why they're so afraid of it, I will never know.
Doctors and nurses, I think, would probably be a major part of my getting better. But I wouldn't miss this any Tuesday.
He put his hands on my eyes and I felt this beautiful warm glow. And when I went out, they were definitely not cured, but I felt better in myself.
Gives me the healing, and maybe it's psychological, but I always feel I'm better after it.
I think that the healers and the ordinary people who know that healing is real and spiritual healing is real, they're posing a great challenge to both the scientific establishment and the church establishment. And they're saying, guys, you need to be converted. Open your eyes. There's more to it than you can see at the moment. And I think a revolution's actually in prospect, that something new is going to emerge. It's going to pull down a lot of the narrow-mindedness of Western medicine and psychiatry and a lot of the narrow-mindedness of Western theology. So we're in for big changes.